Today we answer the question, coral versus Zooxanthellae, which one of these are we actually caring for? And it may actually seem like we're caring for a tank full of corals and thinking about the nutritional needs of the coral. In many ways we actually are, but deep within the coral's tissue is something called Zooxanthellae. It's an algae that lives within the tissue of the coral and utilizes photosynthesis to provide as much as 90% of the energy and nutritional needs of the coral. So the question really is, if we care for the Zooxanthellae, will the Zooxanthellae then care for the coral? Today, specifically in relation to nitrate and phosphate. If we get nutrients right, what can we expect? It's been my experience that when we have a better understanding of not just how nitrogen and phosphorus influences the health of the coral, but also the algae that lives within it, we're gonna see fewer unexplained mortalities, we'll have better control or understanding of what influences the coloration of the coral, and even more important to that, when experiencing challenges, we'll make intuitively better decisions. Nitrogen and phosphorus atoms are the building blocks of DNA, amino acid molecules, and every protein cell on the planet, including plants, algae, animals, and bacteria. It's also critical to storing cellular energy, producing chlorophyll, and turning the sun's energy into metabolic energy for the coral. Without nitrogen and phosphorus, there'd be no DNA, no proteins, no plants, no coral reefs, and no life on Earth. So with that understanding, it's easier to grasp why in that previous episode in this series, we talked about ultra-low levels of nitrogen and phosphorus or nitrate and phosphate and how we can slow down or starve out the algae, and in some cases, not just slow down, but outright kill it. However, that misses the fact that deep within this coral, there's an algae known as Zooxanthellae. So if we're starving out the algae in the tank, what are we doing to the nitrogen and phosphorus needs of the Zooxanthellae that lives within this coral and also provides 90% or more of the energy and nutrition that the coral needs? So again, if we take care of the Zooxanthellae, will it take care of the coral? Or better yet, if we're not taking care of the Zooxanthellae, how will that show up in the coral's health as well? The coral itself is actually an animal and has some needs that are related to that. In this case, it actually needs some oxygen. It needs a source of amino acids, which are the building blocks of protein, which will build all of its tissue. It also needs a source of energy or simple sugars that will support the metabolic function of the coral. But the big question really is where does it get all those things from? The answer, of course, is the Zooxanthellae or algae that lives within the coral. It utilizes photosynthesis to produce all of those things for its own needs. However, it's so efficient at producing those things that it produces way more than it can use itself and then releases all the excess into the coral to support the coral's metabolic needs as well. So what does the Zooxanthellae need to be able to produce those amino acids for itself as well as the coral, the energy for itself in the coral, as well as the oxygen or oxidants to help break down the waste? Well, Zooxanthellae needs light, water, carbon dioxide, a source of nitrogen and phosphorus, as well as other minerals that regulate the photosynthetic process. So this is where the true symbiotic nature of the coral and the Zooxanthellae and how they care for each other really comes together, because the coral actually takes care of the Zooxanthellae as well. First, obviously, by providing it habitat and a safe place to live. Also provides it water. It will provide it CO2 from its own respiration. It will also provide it minerals from captured prey, which may be very hard to find or scavenge in the water. And you might think that the nitrogen and phosphorus comes from the water as well, but in the ocean, that's often into the parts per billion. Much of the nitrogen and phosphorus comes from either digesting prey or from burning the energy that the Zooxanthellae provided to the coral and then providing that nitrogen and phosphorus waste back to the Zooxanthellae. A symbiotic nature where they feed each other. So this is a bit of a chicken and egg concept, which one came first or which one matters more. And if I had to pick one, I would consider the Zooxanthellae first or what the algae needs to thrive, because if I do that, the algae will provide 90% of what the coral needs to thrive. However, this isn't the case of like an apple where if I ate 90% of it, there would be 10% left over, who cares? It's actually the fact that the Zooxanthellae can't reproduce that last 10%. It doesn't have the ability to produce some of the amino acids or provide or scavenge some of the elements. The coral's gonna do that with capturing prey. So that's that last 10%, and in turn, some of the elements that are important to regulating photosynthetic process are also then captured as prey and then passed on to the zooxanthellae. So in terms of nitrogen and phosphorus or nitrate and phosphate, in most ocean reefs, these things are considered limiting factors to growth, meaning there's so little nitrate and phosphate in the water, often the parts per billion, that it actually slows down the population growth of the zooxanthellae within the coral's tissue, and that of course slows down the amount of nutrition that the zooxanthellae can provide to the coral. So if we increase just the nitrate and phosphate availability in the water, often you'll see more nutrition, higher populations of zooxanthellae, and in turn, you'll also see more growth out of the coral. So outside of many test kits, you can actually see this visually in many tanks just by looking at the coral itself. So if you have really low availability of nitrogen and phosphorus in the tank, it'll often look like a pale pastel looking coral just because there's so little of this algae living within the tissue that the natural color pigments of the coral shine through. However, if it's too high and the high levels of nitrogen and phosphorus are promoting rapid growth of the zooxanthellae within the tissue, it will often look like a very dark color coral, often a richer color of its natural pigmentation, sometimes going too far and turning totally brown, which is the natural color of the zooxanthellae. So the more of this you understand and the better you get at applying the knowledge, you might find that just a couple of canary corals are paying attention to the density of zooxanthellae or the color of the coral is actually a better representation of the overall phosphorus and nitrate needs of the tank and how you're doing with it than a test kit itself. However, unlike horsepower, more is always a good thing. High density populations and all the nutrients that come with that may not be actually beneficial to the coral because right along with those things is the increased amount of toxins and byproducts of photosynthesis and oxidants that can harm the coral. The coral actually has to get rid of those things or run the risk of bleaching. Now, if everything else is right, meaning that your flow is perfect, your lighting's perfect, temperature's perfect, you may actually have a healthy coral. However, the increased chance of bleaching comes when, what happens when the temperature rises and the rate of metabolism goes up in the coral and more oxidants are being produced and it has a harder time? Or maybe one of the power heads gets turned off by accident or jammed. Or what if the lighting gets turned up just a little bit or a little bit longer? Now the coral can't deal with those oxidants. It becomes toxic and the coral has to bleach to get rid of all the zooxanthellae within its tissue just in a desperate attempt to survive. So this is another case where more isn't always better, the right amount is. However, outside of just energy, protein, and tissue needs, there's also other considerations, like most of these corals have a calcium carbonate-based skeletal structure, and most of us don't want to intentionally slow it down, and phosphate levels as little as 0.1 may slow it down as much as 50%, an exponential effect that actually happens over time, meaning not just 50% today, but 50% on that 50%, and some people may be able to grow out a tank in 2 years versus five. However, this does matter to most of us, and this is how it happens. This calcium carbonate-based skeletal structure is built by the coral by pulling ions of calcium and ions of carbonate out of the water, combining them together to build that calcium carbonate crystal or the skeletal structure that it lays its tissue on. Now, what also happens is the phosphates also attracted to that calcium carbonate crystal, attached itself to that surface, and then makes it less attractive to new calcium and new carbonate ions, effectively slowing down growth. The more phosphate that's in the water, the more it's going to poison the surface of that calcium carbonate crystal and slow down the growth of the coral, often more than you think. However, one of the ways that we can manage this is consider the difference between inorganic nitrogen and phosphorus that we can test for in our water and the organic prey that has nitrogen and phosphorus within its tissue that the coral captures. And that's up next, nutrients versus nutrition.